Okay, so like there are a lot of different small topics we will be seeing today. Ali, what time is the lunch? Like how? Like, and right now it's 12, na? I think after lunch now, because at least 1 hour sort of.
1 hour.
1 hour, yeah. Like I'll try to finish by 1. Yeah. Okay, so for trees we have, I mean, I can recall of these 4 major data structures. This one is also not used a lot, like this is very rare. We have Euler 2, we have HLD, we have centroid decomposition, and then there's the thing called reachability tree. Okay, so we'll look at them one by one, and like we'll try to analyze when to use what, like which is used for what type of problems and stuff. So yeah, first is Euler 2. Like, when do we use Euler 2? When we have subtree, like we have queries or updates involving subtrees. And what does Euler 2 do? It gives us a way to linearize our tree into an array, so that every subtree of my original tree is a continuous subarray in the linearized array, right? That is essentially what Euler 2 does. And what do we do in case of Euler 2? We just do a BFS, and before entering, we push the element into our linear array, and after we exit, we push our element into our linear array. And then for every element, we have 2 copies of the linear array, like in the linear array, and to know the whole of the subtree for any node will lie entirely between the 2 copies of the linear array. So yeah, all of us know this, fair enough. So this is used for subtrees. How about HLD? So HLD is mainly used for path queries and path updates. And what do we do in case of HLD? We say that we partition our tree into a set of paths. How do we choose that path is given by HLD. And due to that partitioning, the claim is that we can go from, so any path from U to V in the, like any general path from a pair of nodes, like between a pair of nodes UV in the tree, can be represented by a partition, by at max 2 log n different segments of paths, where each of the segment is continuous in my linear array, right? So suppose I have to do a range query or a range update. Instead of doing one range query or one range update, I will have to do at max 2 log n different range queries and range updates. But then every update or query would take approximately log n, so log square n works fine, right? This is the brief overview of HLD, and the selection of the path is based on the fact that I want to go at any node, I want to continue the path that comes to this node to the heaviest child, and by heaviest child I mean the child with the highest subtree size or with the maximum depth, either of them will work. And why does it work? Because we say that on, like, every time we traverse a light edge, the subtree size doubles at least, because it must have a sibling with size at least equal to the current subtree size. So therefore we can jump at max log n light edges before we reach the root. And yeah. So we can argue very similarly, because the maximum depth of the tree can be at max log n. The maximum depth of a tree can be at max order n, and every time we traverse a. Okay, wait. Maybe not. Okay, so. One second. Suppose these were the light edges which we traversed. The depth here has to be at least 1. I think we can argue, like, very similar to the subtree size argument, because even in this case, I don't know how would that relate to this, but. This should work. Thank you. See, so suppose I'm saying that argue the proof in terms of the number of nodes in my subtree itself, but visualize it as the max depth. Because every time I traverse a light edge, suppose my max depth is alpha, then I know that there are at least alpha nodes in my subtree. And after traversing the light edge, there are at least two alpha nodes in my subtree, because my sibling would also have a depth of at least alpha. Right? Like whenever, so suppose I was coming from here. Once again. Multiplicative same. Okay, my bad. I think it might not work. Okay, I'll try to come up with a proof if I can. Like for now, just believe that it works for the subtree sizes, and like forget about the maximum depth. So like I'll post a proof if I'm able to come up with, or a counter example. I'll think about it. Like let's move forward for now. Okay, so yeah, if we choose the child with maximum subtree size as my heaviest child, then we know that. Like we can go between any pair of paths by traversing not more than 2 log n jumps. Like by skipping or like by no more than 2 log n different segments. Okay. So yeah. So HLD is used for path updates and queries. Now how about if you want to do both? Like we want to do all four. Like path updates, path queries, and subtree updates and subtree queries, but together. So it looks hard because we have two different structures, one which takes care of the subtree queries and sizes, like subtree queries and updates, the other which takes care of path queries and updates. But we want a structure which should be able to do both the path queries updates and subtree queries updates. Okay. And how do we do this? So notice that we don't really need these two different structures. Euler tool is just a DFS ordering of the tree, or is just an ordering in which I am visiting the nodes of my tree. And we are making use of that because DFS traversal has the property that once you enter the node, it will visit every node in my subtree and then only come back. Like I will enter and exit a node exactly once, and once I enter the node, I will visit all the nodes in my subtree and then exit. Right? So the DFS, so the Euler tool has this property. Like the DFS has this property, and Euler tool is just exploiting this property by doing a DFS in any order and writing down the nodes. And HLD is just a special way of doing DFS. In case of HLD, the only difference between a normal DFS and the HLD would be that instead of going to any arbitrary child, I first go to the child with the largest size and then go to the rest of the children in any order, right? So HLD is also a DFS ordering. Like, we can do a DFS ordering using HLD as well, or the ordering we obtain by HLD is also a DFS ordering. It is just a different kind of DFS ordering, where at every node I choose to first go to the heaviest child and then go to rest of the children, right? So we could actually just do HLD and when entering a node and while exiting a node, write down the node numbers. I mean, keep track of the node indices, just like we do in case of Euler 2. And on the HLD array itself, every subtree will be continuous. Like, on the HLD array itself, we can do path updates and path queries, and range updates, and subtree updates and subtree queries, because the subtrees of an HLD array will be continuous. Like, the subtrees will be continuous in an HLD array, and we already know how to do path updates and path queries on the HLD array. So we do not need any additional structure, and we can support all four by using just HLD. Does this make sense? Like, is it clear to everyone? Or do you want me to give some example, draw something? Huh? So, suppose this was a tree and we had the subtree sizes in this order. Like, this is the largest, this is the smallest. Okay. In case of Euler 2, we would come at this node and push this node into my additional array. Then choose any child arbitrarily. Suppose this. Go to this child, push it in my array, explore the subtree, and while coming back, again push this child into my array and come back. Right. So I would have the start and end pointers in my array saying that where does this subtree start and end, and the claim is that all the nodes in between will belong to this subtree, and that is because of the property of DFS that we will visit this subtree completely before exiting the node, right? In case of HLD, we choose the heaviest child and we come here and we say that this node also belongs to the path of this node, and we keep doing that until we come down. And then we come back and then we traverse the light edges one by one, right? Like, at any node, yes. Same as? Euler 2 is just a DFS. So any DFS you do can be considered as a tree factoring, right? Because any DFS you start at the root node, you go to some leaf, you come back, you again go to some leaf, you come back, you again go down, and you keep doing this, so on, right? So in case of HLD, the only change is that we choose the heaviest child of the node first to go down in the DFS and then go to the rest of the smaller children. But even HLD, even in case of HLD, once I enter this node, I will completely linearize this subtree. I will completely partition the chains in this subtree and then come back and then go to the next child, right? So even now, all the nodes in this subtree are coming together in my HLD array before I exit and go to the next child. So therefore, the HLD, even in the HLD array, every subtree is a continuous range, a continuous subarray. And we can make use of this fact to do subtree updates and subtree queries as well on the HLD array itself, along with path updates and path queries. So we can handle all four together using only HLD, right? Yes. Does this make sense? Sure? Okay. So we have seen all the tools, we have seen HLD, we have seen how to handle both. Okay. Next, let's see this structure, the HLD tree, and then we'll come to centroid. This is again a like a not very used, sweet and simple structure, which has some nice properties. So okay, the problem is you are given, so there are two types of updates and queries in a tree. The update says given a node X and a distance D, you have a weighted tree and you are given a query, like you are given updates of the form X, D and V, and it says add the value V to all the nodes which are reachable from X without traversing any edge of length greater than D. Okay. So the update says start at X and try to go to every node without traversing any edge which has a length greater than D. Okay. And to all those nodes which are reachable, add the value V. Okay. And similarly, we can have a query that given a X, D, tell the sum of all values at nodes which are reachable from X by not following any edge of length more than D. Okay. How do we do this?
Number 5.
उसका रूटिंग प्रूफ होगा।
So yeah, you guys tried? Yeah. So like you have to do it offline, right? Or
no, the graph is fixed, right? The edges are fixed.
Yeah, but the D is changing in each query, right? Okay, so let's try to look at a solution. Take the original tree and find the edge with the maximum weight in my tree. Okay. Suppose this was the edge with the maximum weight. Okay. I am creating another tree, which I will call the reachability tree. And in this tree, we'll have a property that every internal node represents an edge of the original tree, and every leaf node represents a node of the original tree. Okay. So how many nodes will we have in this new tree? 2n-1. Okay. So I take the maximum edge of my original tree. So I create a new tree using my original tree such that every internal node of this new tree will represent an edge of the original tree, and every leaf node of this new tree will represent a node of the original tree. Okay. So the total number of nodes in my new tree will be 2n-1, n-1 edges and n nodes. The construction is, take the heaviest edge of my original tree, delete it from the original tree, okay, and create a new internal node corresponding to this edge, okay, in the new tree. So I do not have this edge anymore in my original tree. I recurse on both these subtrees formed, and I attach their reachability trees as a left child and a right child of the node I just added. So what this means is, in this subtree, I again find the maximum edge, the maximum weighted edge. I create a node corresponding to that in my reachability tree. Suppose that edge was like this, and this was a leaf node, and this was another tree. I remove this edge and I recurse. Since one part is a single node, like since one half of the since this is just a single node and not a subtree, instead of, so like there are no more edges left here to add in my tree, right? So therefore I'll just add this node as a leaf node. For the other half, I'll continue the regression. And so on. Okay. Is the construction clear to everyone? So every time I take the heaviest, or like every time I take the edge with the maximum weight in my tree, I delete this edge and I add a node corresponding to that edge in my reachability tree. Okay. But once I delete the edge, I have two subgraphs. I recurse on each of the subgraphs, form the reachability tree from each of the subgraphs, and attach it as a left child and a right child of the node I added in my reachability tree. Okay. So this is a binary tree. Every node can have at most two children. Every internal node will have exactly two children, because any edge you remove, you will have two subgraphs formed. And if your subgraph is a single node, if the subgraph formed is a single node, you just attach it. Like the reachability tree is also a single node for that subgraph. Okay. So therefore, every time your recursion ends, it will end on a single node, and that will form a leaf of my reachability tree. Otherwise, every edge will form an internal node. Okay. And the property is that I'm taking the maximum edge every time and removing it. Okay. And forming this tree. Okay. Can we comment anything about the depth of this tree? Login. Huh? Any other comments? Root n, log square n, log cube n. O n. So it can be O n, worst case. You can take a straight line graph with edges in decreasing order. Okay? Tree. Okay. So we have this tree. But why did we do such a weird thing? So now, what is the good property in this original tree? Suppose I take any edge. Suppose I take any internal node in my original tree. Okay. And I take the weight of that edge. all the nodes in the subtree of that edge are reachable from each other by following an edge of weight no more than d. Suppose this edge had a weight d. Okay. At the time of removing this edge, we had this edge as a weight d, and we had a subtree here, and we knew that d is the edge with maximum weight in this whole subgraph, right? We knew that d is an edge with maximum weight in this whole subgraph. Okay. So therefore, you consider any pair of nodes in this subgraph. It should be reachable from one another by following an edge of weight no more than d. Right. And all these nodes will be in the subtree of the node d. Right. And all the nodes which are not in the subtree of the node d, if I consider a path from them to this node, then there must be an edge along on that path of weight more than d. Right. So once we have this tree, the problem reduces to doing updates and queries on a subtree. Because suppose I have to update for some node and some distance d, I want to find the deepest ancestor which has an edge weight of at most d, right? Like I want to find the lowest ancestor which has at most d, or the deepest ancestor which has just more than d. So yeah, like the highest node which has at most d weight, and all the nodes in the subtree of that node will be reachable from the current node with the distance like by following an edge of weight no more than d. Right. Suppose given a pair of nodes, you want to find the edge having the maximum weight along the path from u to v. So given a pair of nodes uv, you want to find an edge which has the maximum weight on the path from u to v. Can we do this using this tree? It will just be the LCA of uv in this tree. Okay, make sense? So this is very rarely used, but it's good to know, and it's not very hard to imagine. You can do the construction using DSU. Like if you start finding the maximum weight, like the maximum edge weight in the subgraph every time in order n, then it will be too much, because as we saw, the height can go to order n, so therefore the number of regression steps can go to order n. So instead of that, you can use DSU to construct this fast. I'll share the links, you can see it's not very hard. Okay, so we have seen these three, and yeah, like my claim for the HLD was wrong. It is not, like in case of maximum depth, it won't be log n, like as he gave an example. So yeah, like forget about it. The example would be something like this. We have a straight chain here, and we have long chains here. So suppose this is alpha minus 1, alpha minus 2, and so on. Then for all these, like these all will be light edges, and we can have root n such light edges. Because like all these chains will be heavy, and therefore all these edges will be light, and if I query between this node and this node, then I'll have to traverse root n light edges. This one? No, no. This will be light, 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 light. Yeah, like in case of maximum depth only. Not surface size. Like suppose for surface size it works, for the maximum depth case it won't work. Anyways. So yeah, like forget about the maximum depth claim. Focus on surface size. What is a linker tree? It's an entirely different data structure which is not considered here. Yeah. Okay. Next we look at centroid decomposition. So in what all cases do we use centroid decomposition? So what does centroid decomposition do? In case of centroid decomposition, every time we find a node which we call as centroid, which has this nice property that no subtree of this node, if you root the tree at this node, there won't be any subtree that has a size more than n by 2, right? And I remove this node and I add this node to my new centroid tree and I recurse on each of these subtrees. The nice property is that the depth is at most log n, because the subtree size in each recursion reduces by half, and therefore we have a centroid tree with log n depth. And any path from U to V, so it is very similar to the reachability tree. If we see, in case of reachability tree, we are like finding an edge with a certain property and removing it, so that both the parts are separated and we recurse on each of the paths. In case of centroid decomposition, we find a node with a good property and like we remove it and we recurse, and any path from U to V can be represented by a chosen node, any path from U to V can be represented as a U to some centroid, and from that centroid to V, such that it was the first time when U and V got disconnected. On removing that centroid, it was the first time when U and V got disconnected, or it was the first time when I removed that particular node during my decomposition, U and V were in different subtrees and therefore they got disconnected, such that the path from U to V can be represented by a concatenation of paths from U to the centroid and centroid to the V, right? So the centroid tree would have a depth of log n, and in each of these levels we will be doing a processing of at max order n, because every node, so at the root we add the whole tree, we chose a centroid and we removed it. Suppose we add k different children, then every node went to exactly one child. So therefore at this level, every original node of my tree which has not been removed yet belongs to exactly one child, or exactly one of the subtrees. So therefore when we do a DFS, or when we process the subtree corresponding to every centroid while finding the centroid on this level, when we root the tree at a centroid and do any processing, every node is being processed exactly once, because every node belongs to exactly one part. And because the depth of the tree is log n, I know that every node can be processed at max log n times, because at every level I process a node exactly once, at most once, if that node is present. And I know that we have at max log n levels, so therefore every node is processed at max log n times, and hence the complexity of the construction and the use comes down to n log n, right? And that, so during the centroid decomposition you would have found x and rooted your tree at x and found the levels or depths of every node in the subtree. So you can maintain a array of depth which is a log n cross n array, okay, and Dij denotes what is the depth of node j at ith level, suppose, okay. we know that the centroid tree will have I level set max. Suppose your node x was at some jth level. Then you root the tree at node x, you root this remaining tree at node x, and you do a DFS and you find the depths of every node in this subtree. And suppose there was this node y, then d of j comma y will be the depth of y when it was, like, when its part was rooted at x, because x was at level j during the decomposition. Depth, like, you can have the weighted weight, you can have levels and depth separated now. Like you can compute the weights, the sum of the weight of path from x to y also during the DFS. Right. Like, by depth I meant the weighted path only.
But to find the weight from x to y, we would need to find it in the original tree.
Yeah, so during the decomposition only you would have processed that, right, in the original tree. The centroid tree is used only to get the x, then the values will be used from the processing you did during decomposition in the original tree itself.
So, like, while construct index, you can get all this.
Yeah, like you can process all these, and for every query you can just find x and answer in order one.
So what is the point of finding the depth in the centroid tree if we need to find, suppose the queries are find the depth of two nodes, find the distance between two nodes. So
LCA in the segment tree can, like, LCA in the centroid tree can be found in order log n, right?
Yeah.
You can just iterate and find, yeah.
Suppose we need to do it in centroid decomposition. So we find the node x and u and v are both in their subtree. Finding the depth of u from x in the centroid tree and plus finding.
You cannot do in centroid tree. That would not make sense. Yeah. So the centroid tree is not. Is the structure for
finding a third node in two paths. Yeah,
to find those two paths which, if concatenated, will give the whole path. Those two paths have to be processed in the original tree itself. Right. Okay. And, like, for finding, so in case you have problems, like, find a path among all possible paths with this certain property. So in that case, we discussed that during the decomposition, like, whenever you root the subtree at some centroid, you process all the paths that pass through this root node. Or one path belongs to a different subtree, other path belongs to a different subtree. And if you can merge their answers and take max over all of them, or, like, whatever function is given to you to compute, like, you can compute that function and choose the optimal among all those possible paths, then you can essentially find the answer using centroid decomposition. For example, if you want to find the longest path in the tree, using centroid decomposition, what do? Like, you root at, so every time you have a centroid, you see all the paths that belong to different subtrees. You take max over all the subtrees, like, you take the max of all the paths ending at here, you take the max of all paths ending here, max of all the paths ending here, and then among those max, you pick the global max and second max, and those are the two deepest paths going in different subtrees, and then you just add their weights and take max over all such during the centroid decomposition. And you can have much more complex functions which can be computed like this. So suppose I give you, report a path, like, report the longest path which is a palindrome in a tree. Like, all such, like, many such functions can be computed and solved using centroid decomposition. Okay. And then you can have other complex structures on top of centroid decomposition while you are processing it. For example, if I ask you, for every I, tell me the number of paths of length I in the tree. For every I from 1 to n, tell the number of paths of length I in the tree. How do you do this?
other subtrees that are possessed before I find number of parts in I minus 1.
And I need to do this summation for all I.
FFT,
yeah. So you'll have to use FFT at every node of, like at every point of decomposition, you'll have to use FFT to combine the answers and add it to the global. So how you are combining the answers can become an independent problem. And you can use any other complex structure, like segment trees, FFT, like anything else. Some string structures, if it is a problem, strings or anything else. But the power that among all possible paths, find a path with a certain property. So among all possible paths, find a certain path is reduced by centroid. And given two paths, how do you combine the answer? Or like given a set of paths, you need to find the optimal. That for that, you might be using some other structure. Okay. So yeah, this is good. And a third type of problem which are solved by centroid decomposition is, given a node x and a distance d, update or query on all nodes which are within a distance d of this node. So given a node x and a distance d, report the sum of values at all nodes which are reachable or like which are within a distance d of x. Remember earlier we said that which are reachable from x without following an edge of length d. In this case, we are saying which are reachable from x, like which are within a distance of x, which are within a distance of d from x. So it means that we have sort of a radius of d around x, and all nodes which fall within this radius should be updated, and so on. Right. So update all these nodes or query on all these nodes. So this is another classic set of problems which are solved easily by centroid decomposition. Okay. Why do you want to? Oh, you do the processing while constructing the centroid tree. Like when I'm constructing the centroid tree, I have the original tree and I found that x is the centroid of this tree. Right. Before removing and recursing, I root the original tree at x and compute whatever function I want to. And then I remove this and recurse on each of the subgraphs. Okay, is this clear to everyone? Now let's look at one last problem. Okay. So suppose you are given a permutation of numbers from 1 to n. And you are given a tree. You will have queries of the form L, R and X. You want to report the summation of so you want to report for a given query L R X, you want to report the summation of all, like the summation of distances of all the nodes in my like of all the nodes in my permutation with the node x, okay, I want to report the summation of distance between pi and x for all I from L to R, and I will have q such queries. Yeah, and the number of nodes in the tree is n, and I have a n length permutation of numbers from 1 to n, and I have q queries. Every query is l r x. Report the sum of distances of all nodes from x that lie between l and r in my permutation.
जाता है फर्स्ट वी कैन ब्रेक द क्वेरीज इनटू टू क्वेरीज लाइक 1 टू li एंड 1 टू ri
ओके
एंड देन वी विल हैव टू बिल्ड अ परसिस्टेंट
ओके ओके ठीक है सो या लेट्स try to see what is happening. So first of all, let's try to solve this problem. Suppose you have a tree and you have two types of updates in queries. Updates is given the node x, activate this node. Initially all the nodes in the tree are deactivated. Okay. The update is given the node x, activate this node, and the query is given a node y, report the sum of all activated nodes from y. Like report the sum of distances of all activated nodes from y in the tree. How can we do this? The query is given a node y, report the sum of distance of y from all activated nodes in the tree. Yeah. No, no, abhi there is no permutation, abhi this is a different problem. Like this is a different problem altogether. Ye ho jayega na centroid se, bas theek hai. So how many of you can think of the solution using centroid? Okay, so we have the centroid tree. Every time we have to activate a node, suppose I have to activate this node, I go to all its ancestors and I add the distance of this node from the ancestor to the, so I go to all its ancestors and so every node will store the sum of all every node in the tree will store the sum of distance of all activated nodes in my subtree from me
and the counter,
okay, and also okay, so like first let's try to see this. So this is what we are storing at every node. So like whenever I have to activate this node, I'll just add a plus 1 to the count and the distance of the node from this node to the sum of distances stored at every ancestor. Now how does this help? Suppose I have to do a query y, like for a given node y, suppose I have to do a query, then the sum stored at the node y will represent the sum of distance of y from all activated nodes in the subtree of y. Okay. Now I go to the ancestor of y. Now I want to add the contribution of all the activated nodes in this subtree specifically, right? Or in all other subtrees which not equal to me. So for that, I look at the sum of distances stored at this node, but that would also count the sum of distances for all the activated nodes in my subtree, and then I subtract the contribution of all the nodes in my subtree from the parent node. For that, I maintain another value called a contribution, where a contribution at a node I is like a contribution at node x is sum of all activated nodes in the subtree of x Like sum of distance of all activated nodes in the subtree of x from its parent. The distance should be from the parent of x and not from x. Okay. If I have maintained that, and this can also be maintained while updating. The distances are all accessed in order 1 now because of the previous thing that we have done. The log n cross n distance array. And like whenever we do a query, I add the sum stored at y. I go to its ancestor. Take its sum and subtract the contribution of y, multiply it and add the, so that sum is the sum of all paths. Suppose like this was the ancestor of y and y was in this subtree, in the original tree, and these were the other subtrees. So the sum stored at this node minus the contribution of y is the sum of lengths of all activated nodes in all of the subtrees that come to y. Now we want to attach all of them to y. So therefore I multiply the distance of y from the parent by the count of the activated nodes. Okay. And I keep doing this for every ancestor. So in log n per update and query, we can do this, that activate a node and then given any node in the tree, report the sum of all activated nodes in the tree from the current, like from the query node. Now let's come back to this problem. We have a query LRX. So we can break this to R, X minus L minus 1, X. Where the query r, x now represents the summation from 1 to r, and this represents the summation of the, like the summation from 1 to l minus 1, because it is sort of a prefix sum, right? So we can break the queries into two queries. We can first find the sum of all nodes from 1 to r and then subtract the sum of all nodes from 1 to l minus 1. So we'll have the sum of all nodes from l to r, the required sum. Okay. Now like now I need some way to answer this, that given the first, like for the first I nodes in my permutation and some node y, report the sum of distances of the first I nodes in my permutation from the node y. I want some way of answering these queries. Now suppose I had a center tree for every prefix of my permutation. For every I had a center tree with me. This can be done offline.
With a single centroid.
This can be done offline with a single centroid tree.
We go from left to right and update.
Keep on updating and then do the queries. Yeah. So like we can do this offline now with a. So suppose we want to do this offline. We are allowed to do this offline. Then we can do it with a single centroid tree. How? Like we just go from left to right in the permutation. For every prefix, I know the number of queries I want to make for this prefix now, depending on the LRX. And I keep on activating. So for every I activate the ith node. I know that the first I nodes are activated. I do all the queries required at the current I. I move on to I plus 1, update, like activate the I plus 1th node in my centroid tree, do all the queries and so on. Okay. So we can solve this offline with a single segment tree. But we can have updates also, and we can enforce an online solution. So anyway, like now we want to look at an online solution. Now suppose I had a segment tree for every, suppose I had a centroid tree for every prefix of this array, like we just saw. Then it is trivial. How? For every prefix, for every I have a centroid tree in which the first I nodes are activated, and given a y, I have to do this query. And we just saw how to do this, right? The only thing is, how can we have a segment tree for every I? Centroid tree, my bad. How can we have a centroid tree for every prefix? So this, like we want to make this centroid tree persistent in a way, right? So that we can have a copy for every I. For every I, we can have a copy. And not spending a lot of time and memory, Okay. So first, let's see, is it even possible to make it persistent? Like let's come to the feasibility. When can we make a structure persistent? When the update and the query, when can we make a structure persistent fast? When, so in case of persistence, every node whose value is changed on an update must be replaced. Like we must have at least as many new nodes in the tree or in the structure as the number of nodes whose values have changed due to an update. Okay. In case of central tree, we know that every update of activation or deactivation affects all the login ancestors of myself. For every login ancestor in the central tree, I change its contribution sum and other values which I have maintained, count and stuff, right? But the good thing is that only my login ancestors are changed and nothing else, right? So this is good. So it looks like we should be able to make it persistent because we are affecting only login ancestors.
But we have to change links for all the children also.
So the thing is, when I say I'm making the centroid persistent, I'm not making it persistent as a structure. I'm not saying that. So after the centroid tree has been created, I want to do updates on the values stored at every node. And I want to make that structure persistent. Right. I'm not making the decomposition part persistent. I'm making the updates and queries part persistent. So the structure of the centroid remains the same. Every update affects, for every update, I activate node X, I go to all its ancestors, and I update the values stored at the ancestors. Right. Now we can imagine the centroid tree as a segment tree or some tree where every node stores some value, right? The structure is fixed. The structure is obtained by the decomposition. The only thing we are changing after every update is the values at every node, and that is what we want to make persistent. That for every version, I want to know what value was stored at what node. After activating the first I nodes for any query, I should be able to know that if the first I nodes are activated, what value will be stored at this node or at every node.
So do you replace a node with a new node?
Yeah, so how do we make a segment tree persistent? So what are the ways of making a segment tree persistent? So we have two main ways of persistence in general for any structure. One is called a fat node method. And other is called path copying. Okay. So in fat node, suppose we talk about a segment tree. And I'm doing a point update and I want to update the path along that update, like affected by that update. In case of fat node, at each node of segment tree, I store a vector. Instead of a single value, I store the vector at each node of the segment tree with a pair time comma value or version comma value. And every time I update a path, every time I go down and update a path with a point update, I push back new values along with the current version in the vector of every node. Okay. So how much time does it take? The update still takes order log n, but the query will now take log square n, because I want to, at every node I do a binary search for the current version in the vector. I pick that value, I go down. So the query now takes log square n, but update still takes order n, and the amount of memory remains the same. The amount of memory is now n log n. This method is called a fat node method because every node can grow fat. So yeah. Okay.
How is the memory n log
n? How is the memory n log n?
So
every update affects order log n nodes, and the number of updates can be n. And in every update, I create log n new nodes because I go down a log n path. So n log n. Okay. So we have. So this is called a fat node method, and this can be used for making other structures persistent as well. So for example, you want to make a DSU persistent. You have. So, like, you want to answer queries on a DSU, but online. So you want to make up a DSU persistent. Even in that case, every time you merge, you can just, instead of having a single value as a parent, you can have a vector as a parent, and push the new parent, comma, version in the node. Okay. So yeah, so like this is called the fat node method. Next we have path copying. The one which is mostly used for segment trees is that if I am creating login new nodes, like once I call an update and the login nodes are affected, for each of the node I create a new node which corresponds to the node for this version. If I am going to the left side, I attach the new node in the left child and I attach the old node in the version as the right child, and I do this for all these login nodes, and I have a new root that corresponds to the segment tree of the ith version, or like the segment tree after the update. I have a new root for that, and to make a query now, I just need to do a search for this, the correct root for the ith version, and then we can query like we did earlier in login, because now we don't need to do a binary search at every node. Maybe we'll have to do a binary search initially to find the correct root, but not at every node as we go down. So this gives us an additive login and not a multiplicative login. So therefore, path copying is used in most cases for segment trees. So these are the two ways we make structures persistent. In case of centroid, we observe that the depth of every node is at max log n. So this is good. But what happens if I try to make it persistent by path copying? So suppose all the login ancestors of this node are affected by an update at this, and I say that okay, I'll create login new nodes with the new values, and I'll attach the children, and I'll have this new node as the new version, like as the new root for this version. Does this work? Right. So the number of nodes we are creating right now still remains order log n, but every node can have arbitrary many children. For example, suppose I have a star graph. And so on. The centroid tree for this graph will be the same tree. Now I update this node. I create this node. Like I create a new node for this and the root, but I need to attach all the n children as a child of root. So this would take order n. The only bad thing right now with the centroid tree is that every node can have arbitrarily many children, which is not the case in case of segment tree, for example. And if we can get rid of this fact, then we can make it persistent and the problem will be done, right? And to get rid of this fact, what we do is we convert the initial tree into a binary tree, or into a tree where every node has at max degree 3. How? Yeah, you can use the fat node method, but it will again be log square n per query instead of log n per query. Path copying will be log n per query and update. And if we introduce updates, then like fat node gets difficult. If I introduce updates of the form swap I and I plus 1. But yeah. So the trick is that we convert the initial tree into a new tree which has every, like where the degree of every node is not more than 3. How? So suppose the original tree was of this form and something. Now we have this node which has a degree more than 3. I keep the parent edge as it is. I'll keep the first edge as it is, like while doing a DFS. The edges can be chosen arbitrarily. For all these, I create a new node, attach this new node to the current node, and attach all these edges to this new node. And I recurse on all the subtrees. Now this node has a degree at max 3, but I have a new node in the tree, the degree of which is 1 less than the degree of the original tree. Right? Does this make sense? And I keep on doing this until the degree of all the nodes in the tree is less than 3. Like less than or equal to 3. So how many new nodes will I be introducing in worst case? N log n. N. Yeah, so for every edge, so for every node which has a degree more than 3, it takes order of degree to reduce it to a node which has a degree less than 3, excluding, so including all the new nodes we are introducing for the, like it takes order of degree for any node which has a degree greater than 3, such that that node and any new nodes introduced do not have a degree greater than 3 anymore, right? And taking the sum over all the nodes gives us n. Okay. So the new nodes in my tree will be less than 2n, in fact. And now we have a, and like for the new nodes and edges introduced, we'll have the weights 0 if distance is the function we are computing, or like based on whatever function we are involved in, like we want to compute, like we can have dummy values for those edges accordingly, so that it doesn't affect our answer. And once we have this tree, then we do a centroid decomposition on this tree. Now, since the degree of every node is at max 3, whenever you root a node at the centroid, you can have at max 3 subtrees. So therefore, in the centroid tree, every node will have at max 3 children and a parent. Okay. And now, the degree of every node in the centroid tree is constant, 3. So we can make this persistent by adding the new nodes, the path copying method. Because now, like the depth will remain log n, the total number of nodes will be 2n. The degree of each node is less than 3. So every update, we just need to introduce log n new nodes, and for every node, we'll have at max 3 children. So this can be handled easily. Very similar to the segment tree. So yeah, we just solved the problem.
The binarization was done on the original tree.
Yeah, the binarization is done on the original tree before centroid decomposition. Four, like one for the parent and 3 for the children.
Why 3 for the children?
Because in the original tree, we have every node to be at, like every node of degree at max 3. And whenever you root a node, like whenever you find the centroid and root the node, it can have 3 subtrees. And for every subtree, we'll have a child in the centroid tree. Okay? Make sense? So yeah, this was persistent centroid. What is the time? 150? 15. Okay, this is all for today. Try out that problem on KMP, which was posted on the group. And if we have time, we can discuss. It's a nice problem. Okay. दो सवाल पूछ के था ना मैंने। दो सवाल पूछ किए थे ना मैंने, देख लेना. हाँ वो अलग है, वो सवाल अलग है. तुम्हारे आजू बाजू के सवाल यूज हुआ है शायद, पता नहीं. स्पॉज में तो यूज हुआ ही है, Q3 4.